Welcome to The Road to Recovery, The Road to Freedom with Mark. This is my 28-minute slot every Friday, and this is my first day on the TV. So please excuse me if it's a little bit rough. It's my first time out, so takes a bit of getting used to, and I must say it's a privilege. Thank you very much for allowing me to do this show. I want to say a special thanks to Michael and Veronica down here at Arrow Radio. They've been wonderful to me. We've been doing the show without a sponsor for quite some time now, so anyone who wants to come on board, more than welcome. Well, my little show is about mental illness. It's about, specifically I suffer from depression, and I have done for a long time now, and I've had my trials and tribulations, but what I would say to anybody who is suffering from mental depression, the most important thing is to put your hand up and ask for help. So often what happens with people who are suffering from depression, they tend to isolate themselves and try and tough it out, you know. That's the way, especially with males in New Zealand, that's the way we generally tend to deal with issues like that, is just tough it out, you know. Big boys don't cry and all that rubbish. What you really need to do is get some decent help. See your doctor. Most important, get some decent drugs, and that will certainly help with things. But also, counselling. It is a very, very good thing to get into. I did. I went to Te Heora down here in Masterton. Wonderful organisation. They do drugs and alcohol as well as dealing with things like depression. And when I was there, they challenged me to look at life from an optimistic point of view, because really it was like a big dark cloud following me around everywhere I went, raining on my parade, and I was never happy. It was never a happy day. They were all pretty dark and pretty tough. And thanks to some good friends of mine, they helped pull me through and included me in their lives, and that's most important. If you know anyone who's suffering from mental illness, the most important thing is to include them and make them part of what's going on. Simple little things like a dinner or a party or just an opportunity to get out, see something different, do something new. The other important thing, well, there's two more important things. One is to get some decent exercise. Now, I took up lawn bowls. Of all things, I never thought I would, but I got into it and I'm really enjoying it. I'm loving it. And the other thing is to make sure you eat well. What tends to happen is you tend not to look after yourself so well. So keeping those routines. And the other thing really most important is to set yourself some goals. They don't have to be big goals, small goals. A weekend trip away, you know, can make a huge amount of difference to your life, to your whole outlook on everything, really. Just that little break, getting away, doing something, working towards a small, simple goal, working towards that challenge and achieving is really, really good for you. Well, it's not just about talking about depression. What I do, I've written a whole load of stories, short stories, and they're about my travels around the world. I travelled for 7.5 years to Africa and Europe and Southeast Asia, and my adventures around New Zealand, and today is one of those adventures around New Zealand. I've met some amazing people in New Zealand, and, you know, we are truly blessed with such a beautiful country, so many resources, and such great fun to be had. Very few people get out and do things these days, and it's most important that you do. It's so easy to take the beauty and all that for granted, and we do tend to do that quite a lot in New Zealand. I don't think we realise what a fantastic country we really have, and I really encourage everyone to go out there, see some of the beautiful sights in the Wairarapa. She's a truly magic place, absolutely beautiful, and I really enjoy getting around the country. Right, without further ado, we'll get on with today's story before we run out of time. And today's story is called A Big Tusker. The old mate, who I'll call Tom for short, and I had been on the trail of a big boar for the last 2 days. Tom allows few others to hunt the 1,000 acres he lives on, so some of the boars get to a huge size. It is a rare privilege to be allowed to hunt a trophy animal, and we were hell-bent on bagging this one. Day one came, we came across the sign we were looking for, with rooted-up thistles, a boar favourite, and shit the size of Coke cans. The dogs stuck to their task well and found the mob late in the day, but were unable to stop them. A single piglet, too small to be of consequence, was all we had to show, despite our best efforts. Despite our initial failure, we became more determined to snare this huge beast. He would undoubtedly be sporting a huge set of tusks or hooks to match his size, and this was the prize we were truly after. We also were determined that the dog should know what their main task in life is. Only a bull will truly test the mettle of a dog, be he finder or bailer. They must stick to the task and come through with the result, hopefully unharmed. Injury and even death is not uncommon for the dogs, but they love this life and they live for the days hunting in the bush. We had 5 dogs for the job. 2 finders, Havoc and Quinn, who were half-brothers. Havoc black and tan and Quinn the grey. Both light-boned and fast over the ground, they can cover vast distances over steep terrain and are ideally suited to the land. Between them, they have flushed many huge hogs, the hooks of which are now displayed around the house, nailed to posts as trophies. Despite the lack of result on day one, we were confident success was only a matter of time. The other 3 dogs we had were our bailers. Old Bob, who was Havoc and Quinn's dad, now getting on in years and injuries, he was near retirement, but still has a great temperament and is handy in a good scrap. Then there is young Meg, the half-sister to Quinn and Havoc. Yet to be tested, we are hoping she will take the lead from her older brothers, so we must have her on the leash for a while, whilst the find is on. For a bit of muscle, we have added Fugly to the ranks. He is a true bailer, a mongrel pit bull type, typically short in the stride and tough in a fight. His name is short for effing ugly, due to his scars. We are probably a little light on bailers for a big mob, but Tom knows the land well and can swing us round upwind of a mob of pigs most times. So far, however, our prey has managed to elude us with a combination of luck, smarts and cunning. But time and the weather are on our side. At the end of day one, we retire home empty-handed, having left the piglet in the bush. The dogs are uninjured and show only a little fatigue after a full day's hunt. Tom and I give them only a little food and water, as we need them to be on top form for day two. After watering the animals in their kennels, Tom and I retire for a good feed, a few smokes and tell a few stories before an early bedtime, ready for a 5 o'clock start the next morning. Day two is still dark and misty as we check over the gear for the next morning's hunt. We travel light with only a sticking knife, binoculars, some twine, water bottle, and Tom's trusty Winchester 30-30 lever-action rifle. Short and powerful, it is our trusty weapon for dropping big boars in tight spots. Kitted up, we let the barking, excited dogs out of their kennels, and they tear around like excited children, marking everything they can. As Tom kicks over the quad bike and I mount side saddle, the dogs jostle for a posse on the back of the tray or fall in behind us as we descend the drive, with the headlight cutting through the dark. At first light, we dismount the quad bike and again in silence we pick up the trail of the mob and follow down into the still damp bush, all wet, dark and spooky. Tracking down from an upwind position, the odds are well stacked in the finder's favour. Soon the finders are on the trail, but the mob now seems spooked after yesterday's harassment and stay moving ahead of the dogs. As the morning wears on, we make contact a couple of times without a successful bail. Over one ridge after another, they lead us on a merry chase without any real contact until the heat of the day forces us to take a break and rest the dogs, who return to us reluctantly. Over our lunch break, we discuss how to get back above and upwind of the mob, how we can force them down to the bottom of the creek if they break, and have a final crack at them down there. Around 1 o'clock, we walk up the firebreaks till we are well above and upwind of the mob. First, we send off the two finders, followed by the bailers 10 minutes later, in the hope that the pack will hit the mobs simultaneously. At around 2 o'clock, despite the heat, we finally hear barking down at a wallow we found yesterday. It is a long way down from where we are, and as we run down, we hear a bale, a break over another ridge, and a second bale. We are forced to swim our way through bracken and fallen trees, and I am thankful for the short rifle. We push on hard and finally come across 3 dogs attached to a good-sized sow. Being stretched 3 ways, she has little chance of escape, and I am able to reach in between 2 dogs and tip her up by grabbing a hind leg. Tom is then able to stick it as I hold it on its back. The sow was dispatched of with all efficiency and its suffering is minimised. When gutted, all of its innards still quiver and pulse with ebbing energy. Although not the intended target, it is a good size, some 60 to 70 kilos, and makes for a hard haul up a ridgeline till at last I collapse out onto the firebreak. To conserve energy, we decide to walk back to the quad bike and drive back to the carcass. Only 3 dogs return to us, with the 2 finders still out after the boar, so we decide to wait up top in the hope they will manage to stop him and perhaps finish the day off brilliantly. After a couple of hours, the finders return, their necks and faces covered in blood, but without any obvious injuries. All the dogs have come through the end of today unscathed, and we have to satisfy ourselves with a good-sized sow. We are more determined than ever to corner the big boar, although the mob have now become weary and skittish. We return home tired, but still with plenty of light left in the day. We kennel the dogs, singe the pig, then Tom dresses the carcass in the chill house, where it's left to set. We spend the rest of the afternoon preparing a big feed, smoking and drinking coffee. After dinner, we clean the rifle and go over the plan for day 3 before heading to bed not long after dark. All right, we'll take a little bit of a break there and I'll play you some 660.
Everything I know and trust.
Welcome back to The Road to Recovery, The Road to Freedom with Mark. This is my 28-minute slot every Friday where I bring to you one of my stories from overseas and I talk a little bit about mental depression and hopefully help one or two people, and that's what my show is really all about. It's about giving hope to other people to help and to reassure people that depression is not the end, you know, it's just the beginning. Well, it's great to be on TV, although I must admit I'm an absolute technophobe. And Michael here at the show, down at the radio station, has just told me what buttons to push. So bear with me if it's a little bit rough today. It's my first day, so let's hope she goes smoothly. All right, time's ticking along, so we'll get back with today's story, the Big Tusker. Day 3, we make another start before dawn. The dogs have no injuries and have lost none of their enthusiasm, tearing around like kids at play. We let them calm down a bit before we head off. Cool heads are required today if we are to finally get onto the Big Tusker. We decide to ride as little as possible today and walk in a few kilometres so as not to spook the mob. It is a slow trudge along the fire breaks, taking in a butte sunrise and mist rise off the bush. Birds are about everywhere. Insects hum and a light breeze of about 10 knots is again in our favour. We have a pretty good idea where the pigs will be and which way they are likely to break, as the mob seems to follow roughly the same journey daily. Up near the tops in the cool of the morning and working down to a wallow, then down to a flat creek near the bottom of the property in late afternoon. I am tired of the slog, but the prospect of a battle with the elusive boar keeps me going. The dogs have lost none of their enthusiasm, and Tom seems to be taking it all in his stride. The finders start to sweep, and a couple of hours tick by as our wary adversaries continue to elude us. At around 9 o'clock, we finally hear a high-pitched bark as a finder suddenly strikes the mob down near the wallow. We are quickly in pursuit, just behind the bailers, and I feel a renewed energy as I draw near the ensuing action. We hear the engagement break off, then restart over the next ridge. The going is steep, but I am driven on by what I am sure is a deep grunt and then a squeal. We come up over the ridge to witness an all-in brawl on a steep face covered in flax. Three dogs are onto a massive hog, well in excess of 120 kilos. The boar is holding his own, backing up the face and using his hooks to good advantage, keeping the dogs out in front of him. They cannot swing him round on the steep face, and Tom tries to whistle up the other two dogs, hoping to use numbers to overwhelm the Goliath. The slip face is too steep for us to get on, and the dogs do their best to drive him to us, but the boar continues to back up and thrash his vicious-looking tusks at the dogs. Finally, the other two dogs turn up and enter the fray. The dogs are fearless, despite the huge and dangerous adversary. Slowly, superior numbers start to tell, and the dogs get to the boar's hindquarters to give him a stretch. The big hog simply grunts and thrashes around wildly, refusing to move from the safety of the slip face where he has more advantage. Mid-fight, Fugly is sent tumbling down the face, only to come roaring back up, and old Bob gets a hook in the guts, but is nimble enough to avoid serious injury. Tom and I are helpless bystanders until the dogs can force the boar off the slip face, as it is far too steep for us and too dangerous for us to attempt shooting the beast with all the dogs on him. Despite the attentions of five willing dogs, the boar has us at a stalemate. He cannot back up much farther, the dogs cannot turn him, and we cannot assist the dogs. The dogs, however, show their grit, and an hour-long battle ensues where no quarter is given, and I fear for the safety of the hounds. It would be a hell of a place to have to get an injured dog from. As the battle wears on, the big tusker slowly begins to tire, and the dogs begin to gain ascendancy, constantly attacking from all quarters with great tenacity, and they begin to pry him from the slip face. Driving from the hindquarters, they work the boar towards us on the ridge. Suddenly realising that he is beaten, the boar makes a dash for the gap between us and the dogs, but Tom is ready and draws a bead on the boar and peels off a shot as the pig reaches the ridge. The big tusker is felled by a beautiful heart-lung shot and lets out a grunt as he collapses on the ridge. The dogs pile in, their blood still up, and we pull them off as life drains from their adversary. At last, we get to see the beast up close, and I am disappointed to see his tusks are uneven. A nice, large, even set is preferable. Still, they are a pretty impressive set. Got to go 100 kilos gutted, muses Tom, as he calms the dogs and draws his knife. We gut the pig on the ridge, as he is too big to move elsewhere, the carcass being nearly as long as us, about 6 foot or 190 centimetres. Let's just take the head, I suggest hopefully, but Tom will have none of it. There are back stakes for us, a good photograph, and loads of dog tucker to be considered. So we tie front and rear trotters together, and between us begin the arduous pull up the ridgeline. We have to stop a few times, battling the heat and steepness of the ridge, but finally collapse exhausted onto the firebreak. The elation of finally capturing our foe gives us renewed energy as we stroll back to the quad bike with all the dogs in tow. Though old Bob took a poke and Fugly is smashing, the dogs are relatively unharmed and seem calm and very pleased with themselves. After an hour, we reach the quad bike and drive back to the boar with the dogs in tow. We have difficulty tying the huge boar on the back, and I must sit on the front to counterbalance the huge weight. We motor back slowly in the heat of the day like a couple of excited kids. Our quarry, though imperfect, is a real trophy and would win many a competition. Apart from its size, it has one large tusk and one broken one. It will make a fine addition to our Hall of Fame back at Tom's place. We arrive back in the afternoon for the obligatory photo session. With the pig on his back, the hog's backside nearly touches the ground, such as the length of the tusker. We hang it in the chill house with the sow from the day before, bow singed and ready to be butchered. We then kennel the weary dogs with a well-earned praise and a good feed of pig. Soon a brew and a feed are underway, and we settle down to clean the rifle and chat about the last few days, how the dogs did and what we could have done better. The elation of success still glowing warm in our tired bodies. After a shower, we cook up a big feed for tea, then sit on the porch, smoking and telling stories till we fall asleep. I stumble off to bed, my head full of dreams of pig hunting that will replay themselves for years to come. The end. Well, I hope you enjoyed today's story. I certainly enjoyed doing it. It's nice to be on TV for the first time ever. And we look forward to quite a few more. So just as a final note, if you know anyone who's suffering from depression, be that difference maker and be there for them. And you never know, you just might save a life. And what a great thing it would be. All right, well, thanks for tuning in. I hope you enjoyed the show. There's plenty more to come, and I'm certainly looking forward to it. So thanks, and we'll catch you again next week. Bye for now. But I